The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
Without freedom of the press, no democratic form of government could exist.
We switch you now to London.
I'm standing on a rooftop looking out over London.
Good night and good luck.
Good evening from our CBS newsroom in New York.
NBC presents Chet Huntley and David Brinkley.
From ABC, this is World News Tonight. With Peter Jennings in London, Max Robinson in Chicago, and from our desk in Washington, Frank Reynolds.
Good evening.
This historic legislation, the telecommunications law, will create many, many high-wage jobs, will create opportunity and better lives for all Americans.
When the press is free, the people of a country are free. When the press is not free, the people of a country are in danger of slavery.
Keeping you informed with information, news, and the views of people making the news. It's the Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
I'm here now with the latest cast-off from The Bachelor Hanoi, fresh off his second meeting with North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. I don't see a rose. Does that mean no denuclearization?
We didn't sign anything today. It didn't quite work out.
Did you guys do it?
I just don't think maybe either of us were ready.
So does that mean we can expect a third date?
We'll see what happens. Again, the relationship is very good. He likes me. I like him. Some people say, oh, you shouldn't like him. I said, why shouldn't I like him?
Maybe because he's a deranged dictator who starves his people and executes members of his own family. But, you know, we all have... My boyfriend doesn't put down the toilet seat, so... Men.
Well, no, I just think he's... First of all, he's... He's a character.
What's your response to critics who accuse you of consistently siding with foreign adversaries over your own intelligence officials?
Why shouldn't I like him? I like him. Get along great.
Uh-huh. And what do you say to those who worry that your naivete and reckless behavior are jeopardizing national security and putting us all in grave danger?
We'll see what happens. Again, the relationship is very good.
You would think he'd obey when his own intel agencies tell him to watch out for Putin and Kim.
He's a real personality, and he's very smart. He's sharp as you can be, and he's a real leader.
But he's too egocentric to do what those men think is best for the country instead of for him.
He likes me. I like him.
Some people say, oh, you shouldn't like him. I said, why shouldn't I like him?
Yet he's as obedient as a tiny pup. For any louse on a nuclear list.
Look, bottom line, I think he wants to get something done.
'Cause when his own daddy issues start flaring up, there's not a psychopath he can resist.
He's sharp as he can be, and he's a real leader.
So unabashedly he reveals.
And he's very smart.
Those sad, lovely feelings he feels. He gets horny for absolute power. Treacherous goons put a gleam in his eye. His taste in men stinks. Now he says that he thinks he's in love and we're all gonna die. He goes mad for a mad crazy tyrant who rapes and pillages, murders and lies. Merely faux pas he lets slide just because he's in love with these wonderful guys. Of a snitch under oath on a witch hunt or anyone who disagrees. He's a hater, but ruthless dictator sure make him go weak in the knees. He goes cuckoo for criminal con men. What they're all selling, he's eager to buy. And while they play him, he's happy to say he's in love, 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 and we're all gonna die.
And then we fell in love.
Okay?
No, really. He wrote me beautiful letters. And they're great letters.
Sure, it seems treason-y, but can't you see he's in love with a wonderful guy? He's so thirsty for thugs and delinquents. There's not a Nazi he can't justify. And he could cream from an evil regime.
Sorry, kids.
But we're all gonna die.
Just kidding.
He gets misty for misogynists. He gives dirtbags the credit they're due. At a summit, he plays it so dumb, it's no wonder they all love him too. He gets boners for bloodthirsty monsters.
He'll take their side every time they deny.
Though he's appalled when it comes to a Baldwin, he loves autocratic, tyrannical, lying, oppressive, despotic, inhuman, plain, awful, maniacal, vicious, sadistic, and vengeful, atrocious, and all around a host with no peace and love, and we're all gonna die.
He likes me. I like him.
Great.
Oh, the awesomeness that is Randy Rainbow. I can't think of a better way to, start the week. Yeah, we were supposed to be here yesterday. Welcome to a Wednesday show, everyone. I'm Nicole Sandler. Voice is a little bit hurting. If you were here Friday, I told you then I was getting sick. I was coming down with something, and I spent the whole weekend not to give you all the gory details, but coughing and sick and everything. And yesterday, I still wasn't really feeling better, but I was going to do a show anyway. After all, it's Tuesday. It's got a laugh day. It's my easiest day of the week because Laffy brings all the tweets and I get to just react. I can get by with a minimum of show prep, which I did yesterday. I was all set to go. And about 1:30, the show starts at 3:00. So at about 1 o'clock, or I'm sorry, at about 1:30 Eastern time, my power went out. Now, I mean, I was sick, but I was going to do a show anyway because, I miss enough shows as it is. So I was able to make my way into the studio and do all my show prep. And again, I don't work far from home. Studios in the house. So I was going to do the power goes off. Now I live in Florida. And what happened was it rained yesterday. Now it doesn't usually rain this time of year in Florida, especially like a thunderstorm. And yesterday was a big, nasty thunderstorm. But, there's no weird weather going on around the country, around the world or anything. But so I figured, well, it'll come back on because it's Florida Power and Light. And they do that all the time. The power goes on and comes off. It goes off and comes on. You know what I'm saying. And so I waited and I waited and I waited. And, thankfully I could tweet and go into the chat room, at least at NicoleSandler.com, and go in the chat room there and at least alert people as to what was going on. And finally, at about 10 minutes to 3, showtime is usually 3 o'clock, at about 10 to 3, I finally called in. I said, oh, well, power's not coming back on. Laffy had been standing by. I told her, just go, do it next time. And of course, I mean, it's the Peter principle, right? That's the one when something can go wrong, it does. The 3:01 p.m. power comes back on. But I think something was telling me that I really should just, take the day off. So I did. But here we are. It's Wednesday. There's a lot going on. Jason Leopold, my dear, dear friend. And I hate it when I watch like MSNBC, Stephanie Ruhle is the worst. Everybody is her dear friend. it just sort of pisses me off because it just seems so disingenuous. But Jason Leopold really is my friend. I adore Jason. I don't even remember how we met, probably online. And I interviewed him a number of times. And he just became a very, very dear friend of mine who I adore. Jason is an amazing investigative journalist who these days is writing for BuzzFeed News. And he and his writing partner, a reporting partner, Anthony Cormier, had a Murphy's Law. Thank you, John Doe. I don't know. Again, my brain is still a little off. So Jason back in January had a big story, a big scoop at BuzzFeed about the headline read, President Trump directed his attorney Michael Cohen to lie to Congress about the Moscow Tower report. And other journalists tried to obviously validate the story, and they couldn't. And then, sorry, I'm looking at the chat room. I shouldn't do that when I'm trying to make a point. Other news organizations couldn't confirm the reporting that Jason and Anthony published. And then Mueller's office did what they've never done, and they weighed in. They made a statement. They said BuzzFeed's description of specific statements to the special counsel's office and characterization of documents and testimony obtained by this office regarding Michael Cohen's congressional testimony are not accurate. And then the entire media sort of piled on. And I had been, you know, talking to Jason offline, and, you know, he's got thick skin, so he could take it. But I'll tell you what, Michael Cohen went before the House Oversight Committee last Wednesday with the cameras running, and he basically validated everything Jason Leopold reported in that story. So Jason's been vindicated. And there's lots more to come. In fact, today, Michael Cohen is back before the Intelligence Committee, albeit behind closed doors. And the latest is, hold on, let me find the CNN is reporting from today's closed hearing. This off from Twitter, from Manu Raju. Michael Cohen gives House Intel new docs showing edits by Trump attorneys to false written statement he delivered to Congress in 2017 about the Trump Organization's pursuit of the Trump Tower Moscow project into the 2016 campaign season. Another thing that was in that story that, you know, everyone decided to poo-poo. Anyway, Jason Leopold will be here today to talk about all of it. And as much as he can tell us, because I know he's in the middle of other big stories as well. So all that and more. There's a lot going on today. So I'll tell you what. Let's do it live.
We'll do it live. Fucking thing.
I read the news today.
Oh boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
Well, another day, another Trump lie about another Trump scandal unfolds. The latest accusation against Trump is that he pressured then Chief of Staff John Kelly and White House counsel Don McGahn to grant his daughter and senior advisor Ivanka Trump a security clearance against their wishes. Both men refused, the sources say, so Trump went ahead and gave her the clearance, which the president apparently has the legal authority to do. CNN's Pamela Brown broke the story.
We've learned that President Trump pressured his then Chief of Staff John Kelly and White House counsel Don McGahn to grant his daughter and senior advisor Ivanka Trump a security clearance against their recommendations. This is according to three people familiar with the matter speaking to me and my colleague Caitlin Collins. Well, as you know, the president has a legal authority to grant clearances, but most instances are left up to the White House Personnel Security Office, which would then determine whether a staffer should be granted one after the FBI conducts a background check. But after concerns were raised by the personnel office, President Trump pushed Kelly and McGahn to make the decision, saying things like, it's no big deal, they'll probably be leaving soon, going back up to New York, so that it didn't appear that the president himself was tainting the process in his family's favor. Now, after both refused, Trump granted the security clearances, according to sources we've been speaking with. And of course, this development comes on the heels of the New York Times reporting, Anderson, that Trump ordered Kelly to grant Ivanka's husband, Jared Kushner, a top security clearance, despite concerns raised by intelligence officials. White House Press Secretary Sarah Sanders says the White House cannot comment on security right. clearance issues, nor can it respond to every anonymous source. Kelly could not be reached for comment, and McGahn declined to comment for the story.
Of course they did. Well, like father, like daughter. In a recent interview on The View, Ivanka denied her father was involved.
There are a lot of people that question whether you were given special treatment by the president, overriding other
Absolutely
officials. Not. Can you speak to that?
There were anonymous leaks about there being issues, but the president had no involvement pertaining to my clearance or my husband's clearance.
So what were the problems early on?
There weren't any.
There weren't any. The president had no involvement with my husband's or my clearance at all. The White House has rejected a request from Representative Elijah Cummings, chairman of the House Oversight Committee, to hand over documents related to that security clearance process for Jared Kushner and, of course, now other Trump aides. The White House counsel called the request, quote, radically intrusive. Well, yesterday, Trump suggested that the White House won't cooperate with the Democrats at all, saying, quote, and you'll notice I'm not playing the sound of Trump actually speaking because I know how much you hate that. So here's Trump. Here's the quote. President Obama, from what they tell me, was under a similar kind of a thing. Didn't give one letter. They didn't do anything. They didn't give one letter of the requests. Many requests were made. They didn't give a letter.
Bullshit.
Yeah. See, from 2011 to 2016, the Obama White House produced hundreds of thousands of documents to Congress on Solyndra, remember that, Benghazi, Fast and Furious, CAFE standards rule, Deepwater Horizon spill, the ACA website, the Clean Water Rule, and the Fort Hood shooting, just in case you're counting. Yeah. Michael Cohen is back before a closed session of the House Intelligence Committee today. It was just a week ago. Just 1 week ago today that we witnessed this exchange between Michael Cohen and Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez at the House Oversight Committee hearing.
To your knowledge, did the president ever provide inflated assets to an insurance company?
Yes.
Yes.
Who else knows that the president did this?
Alan Weisselberg, mm-hmm. Ron Lieberman, and Matthew Calamari.
And where would the committee find more information on this? Do you think we need to review his financial statements and his tax returns in order to compare them?
Yeah.
Yes, and you'd find it at the Trump Org.
Boom. The New York Times is reporting today that New York State regulators have subpoenaed Donald Trump's insurance broker, thanks to, of course, that line of questioning from AOC. All right, so it's been about a week. A little less since Donald Trump's failed summit in North Korea with his BFF, Kim Jong-un. Well, now satellite images appear to show that North Korea is rebuilding a facility that had been previously used to test long-range missile engines. NBC News broke the story yesterday.
Courtney Kuby, Andrea Mitchell, Carol Lee are now reporting that within 48 hours after Trump left following that disastrous failed summit, North Korea was already rebuilding a key long-range missile site, a site that had essentially been dormant since Trump's first meeting with Kim Jong-un last year. According to this exclusive NBC News report tonight, that missile site is now showing activity consistent with, quote, preparations for a test. We know this thanks to commercial satellite images obtained by NBC News. These images were taken March 2nd. That's 2 days after the summit fell apart. The images show what experts say is renewed activity at this long-range missile launching site. And I should clarify, these images don't show an actual missile being moved to the launch pad, but one of the authors of this report points out, quote, they have already tested a few of these, and it looks like they are preparing the launch pad for another act.
Okay, there's another hearing going on today. You know, Congress, Democrats are in control of the House. So Secretary of Homeland Security, Kirstjen Nielsen, is being grilled by the House Committee on Homeland Security today. House Democrats are reportedly planning to grill her on a whole host of border security issues, ranging from eminent domain seizures along the southern border to Trump's zero-tolerance immigration policy to the deaths of migrant children in government custody, as well as the veracity of her own past statements to Congress. Early in the questioning, she admitted that, well, she really didn't know offhand how many children we are holding in custody.
Let me ask you, do you have a census of all of the children that are being detained in the various facilities, both the ones at the border and others that are in partnership with HHS? Do you know how many young people are detained?
Yes, ma'am. I don't have that number in front of me. We have all of the numbers.
Would you provide that for me?
Yes.
She didn't have that number in front of her. She's going to testify before the House Committee on Homeland Security, knows that this will be a line of questioning, but she doesn't have the number of how many children the United States is holding in custody? This exchange, Bonnie Watson Coleman, Congresswoman from New Jersey, asked about the cages.
What is a chain link fence enclosed
into a chamber on a concrete floor represent to you? Is that a cage?
It's a detention space, ma'am, that you know has existed for decades.
Does it differ from the cages you put your dogs in when you let them stay outside? Mm-hmm. Is it different?
Yes.
In what sense?
It's larger. It has facilities. It provides room to sit, to stand, to lay down.
So did my dog's cage.
Sit, stand, and lay down. Jackson can do all those things. Amazing. Wow. All kinds of crazy are on display at this hearing, in which we got to hear Congressman Clay Higgins of Louisiana's genius. You might remember Higgins from last week's hearing with Michael Cohen. He's the one who admitted he hadn't heard of Michael Cohen before that day.
You noted earlier today, Mr. Cohen, quite incredulously, one of my colleagues asked you regarding the television deal. You expressed wonderment that your predicament could possibly get you on television. It certainly got you on television today, has it not, sir?
Sir, I was on television representing Mr. Trump going back into 2011.
Well, I didn't know who you were until today, really.
This is the same guy in that same hearing with Michael Cohen who couldn't grasp the concept that the documents that Michael Cohen produced were in a box that had been returned to him by the FBI. It was one of the boxes they took in the raid of his hotel room and his home and his office that they returned to him. Clay Higgins could not understand that the documents were returned to him after they had been, taken. Unbelievable. Anyway, today, Clay Higgins sits on the Homeland Security Committee. And he said this.
You noted earlier today, Mr. Cohen, quite incredulously, one of my colleagues asked
you. I'm sorry, that's the wrong one. This is the one from today.
Let me just put this in context for the American people.
Yeah.
Perhaps the most famous invasion in the history of the world, D-Day. 73,000 American troops landed in the D-Day invasion.
Okay.
We have 76,103, according to my numbers, apprehensions along our southern border last month.
What?
We have D-Day every month on our southern border.
We
just to put this in context for America. Yes, physical barriers work. Enhanced technology works.
My God. Incredulously, D-Day is just like the, asylum seekers coming to the border. I just bring them to you. New numbers are out today from the Commerce Department that show, despite more than 2 years of Donald Trump's America First policies, the United States last year posted an $891.2 billion merchandise trade deficit, the largest in the nation's 243-year history. You hear that? A broader measure of the nation's trade performance, which includes the services sector, showed a $621 billion deficit. That reflected a deterioration of more than $100 billion from the figure Trump inherited from President Barack Obama. MAGA! MAGA! Somebody's asking me in the YouTube chat room about my little Elizabeth Warren action figure. Listeners, Marie and Melissa sent this to me, along with a Bernie action figure, which is missing from my studio, and I can only surmise that my daughter came in and took him because she thinks that anything that's mine is hers. So I'm going to have to... But anyway, this is Elizabeth Warren action figure. I believe it's available on Amazon. And again, I've got the Bernie one here somewhere. Hopefully he'll be back where he belongs, right behind me by tomorrow. Okay, more news. There's more stuff going on. Back in December, Donald Trump made a pronouncement. Do you remember this? He said, we had defeated ISIS in Syria and we were bringing all of our troops home. Sorry. Sorry to assault your ears. This is Donald Trump from December of last year. Sorry.
We've been fighting for a long time in Syria. I've been president for almost 2 years and we've really stepped it up. And we have won against ISIS. We've beaten them, and we've beaten them badly. We've taken back the land, and now it's time for our troops to come back home. So our boys, our young women, our men, they're all coming back, and they're coming back now. We won, And that's the way we want it. And that's the way they want it.
Oh, God, the man is just demented. Anyway, now, 2 months later, he's flipped. He wrote to members of Congress that he agrees 100% with keeping a military presence in Syria. Just saying. Oh, boy, we're getting close to the bottom of the hour. Okay, a couple more things. Remember Aaron Schock, the Illinois congressman who decorated his office at taxpayer's expense a la Downton Abbey? Well, he was charged with 24 counts, including wire fraud, mail fraud, theft of government funds, making false statements, filing false election reports, filing false tax returns. Well, today, This is unbelievable. Federal prosecutors in Chicago have agreed to drop all corruption charges against him if he complies with what's known as a deferred prosecution. Schock must repay $68,000 to his congressional campaign committees, as well as about $42,000 to the IRS. If he does that and stays out of trouble, he would be left with a clean record after 6 months. And he also said that he's that he's considering a return to politics. Give me a fucking break. And finally, a new poll from Quinnipiac shows that 2/3 of Americans believe our sitting president is a criminal.
When asked by the Quinnipiac University poll, did President Trump commit crimes before becoming president? 64% of voters say yes, the president did. Only 24% say he did not. On whether Trump committed crimes after becoming president, 45% say yes, 43% say no. In the poll taken from Friday through Monday, voters say they are more likely to believe the president's former lawyer, Michael Cohen, at 50%, versus 35% who believe Trump in their back and forth. And 58% believe Congress should do more to investigate Cohen's claims about President Trump's unethical and illegal behavior. 35% disagree. But nearly 6 in 10 voters, 59%, are against Congress beginning impeachment proceedings against the president. Cohen is scheduled to appear at another private session of the House Intelligence Committee today.
Yep, he is there right now as we speak. Where, well, we'll get to it with Jason Leopold in just a couple of minutes. Meanwhile, respondents to this Quinnipiac poll opposed the border wall 55-41% and disapprove of Trump's national emergency 66-31%. I don't know what's so difficult. Okay, you know what? We'll take a very, very, you know what? We'll take a quick break. We'll take a very quick break and come back on the other side with my friend Jason Leopold. My friend Jason Leopold of BuzzFeed News next.
The Nicole Sandler Show is 100% listener supported. Have you given yet? Nicole decided not to put her show behind a paywall, knowing that many can't afford the luxury of paying for a podcast. But if you're able to, she needs your financial support to continue doing this. Consider a monthly subscription. Give when you can. Just visit NicoleSandler.com/donate. Remember, she can't do this without you.
This is a huge, huge issue.
And we're talking about it. The Nicole Sandler Show on Progressive Voices and NicoleSandler.com.
All right, we are back. And as I mentioned earlier, my friend Jason Leopold is a senior investigative reporter for BuzzFeed News. And yeah, he happens to be one of my favorite people. Jason, you there?
I'm here. How are you, Nicole?
I'm okay. How are you?
I'm doing okay. It's been quite a month.
It has been.
Well, month and a half, right? If you could imagine.
Oh, my God. As I was telling the listeners at the top of the show, a little bit of the background setup, you've been writing, how long have you been at BuzzFeed now? A couple of years?
Actually, 2 years, yeah.
Wow. And you've been doing this for a long, long time. I think you were still at Truthout when we met. You've been doing amazing investigative reporting. And I'm never surprised when I see a blockbuster report break and find out that you're the journalist reporting it. So in January...
Thank you.
It's true, because you do amazing work. So Anthony, is it Cormier? How do we say his name?
Cormier.
Anthony Cormier, who you write with at BuzzFeed, he's your reporting partner. How do you refer to him?
Yes. Reporting partner,
okay.
Would be correct.
Cool.
Yeah.
So you and he published one of those blockbuster stories. The headline read, President Trump directed his attorney, Michael Cohen, to lie to Congress about the Moscow Tower project. And then, everyone was you know, talking about the report. Other news organizations tried to verify it and couldn't. And then Robert Mueller's office did something that they hadn't done before and issued a statement disputing the accuracy of the report. It was a really cryptic statement.
Well, let me just interrupt you on
please.
That one. And it's important,
okay.
You know, because
yes.
at this stage, a month and a half later, a little over a month later,
mm-hmm.
we're into sort of parsing words.
Yes.
And that's important, right? Because it's important in the context of what rises to the level of criminal behavior.
Right.
But what Robert Mueller's office did was not dispute our report. What his office released was a very, very carefully worded legal statement that was somewhat also, you know, ambiguous.
Right. Well, I have it here.
Stated,
here's what they said.
Yes.
BuzzFeed's description of specific statements to the special counsel's office and characterization of documents and testimony obtained by this office regarding Michael Cohen's congressional testimony are not accurate.
Right. And so we... As you can imagine, when that statement came out, we were floored. I mean, we were given a heads up that they were going to release a statement, and it was shocking. Because
right.
In the 2 years, 2 years nearly, that Robert Mueller has been investigating the allegations of collusion with the presidential campaign
mm-hmm.
in Russia, he hasn't said a word.
Yep.
About any story.
Nothing.
Not a single story. And so this was the first time his office was making a statement about a specific story. And it was like a nuclear bomb
right.
was dropped on our story.
Yep.
And it immediately led people to, you know, to obviously, you know, state and understandably that, you know, one, that, our story was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Two, that that other people were also trying to figure out, well, what is exactly, you know, once they started to kind of absorb the statement, well, what exactly does it mean? And, you know, three, well, what is he actually saying it's wrong, or is he taking issue with a specific part of the story?
Right.
And, you know, yeah, I should sort of note, kind of bring you behind the scenes, that when we reported this, which was late on a Thursday evening of, I believe it was January 17th,
mm-hmm.
That the story just took off, you know.
It was everywhere.
Late in the evening, we published it, and it just took off. I went to sleep late that evening.
I bet.
And woke up the next morning to...
attacks.
You know...
Oh
yeah, it was. That's what happened, is that it started to turn very personal.
Mm-hmm.
Almost immediately, CNN leading the charge on that.
Amazing.
And so, you know, part of it is that that's not a huge surprise, but it also was interesting because I know that there were many, many reporters that are out there, you know, that cover this, that are in D.C., and I was in D.C. at the time. That just could not match our story,
right.
Or we're attempting to, and we're unable to do so. So, and you know, we wanted other reporters to match us. We wanted other reporters.
Sure,
to,
you want them to confirm,
you know, to stand
what
this
you
up.
Found. Sure.
Right. And one, they were unable to do so, and two, they seem to be more caught up in writing about us, right? Making it about us with CNN, like I said, leading the charge.
And let me just say, you've been totally open about your past. There were a couple of incidents early on that you got a couple of stories wrong. You had a bad tip on something, and you dealt with substance abuse, which you wrote about in a brilliant memoir called News Junkie that I highly recommend everyone read. I'm telling you, I read it in one sitting. I literally couldn't put it down. It was that good, that compelling of a story.
Thank you, Nicole.
So it's true, and it's still available. You should read it because it gives you great insight into who Jason is and his background. And so you weren't hiding anything, but they decided to make this a personal attack on you.
Yes. And, you know, the way that everyone knows about my past is because I'm the one who put it out
exactly.
there. So the idea that this is being brought up was, again, it wasn't a surprise. But it was striking as to how quickly that happened. And it you know, made me wonder, like, what is happening behind the scenes as this story is sort of taking off, not just here, but around the world. I mean, I received, you know, emails and text messages from people I know in London saying it's on the news there.
Oh, my God.
You know, and in terms of the mistakes, of course, I've been open with that. But they were also decades ago.
Sure.
You know, they're decades ago. That took place decades ago. I'm not dismissing the seriousness of the mistakes. But, you know, I've also done in the years plenty of other work that have written lots of stories that, you know, that have been proven obviously to be true.
Exactly.
Right. So it was very odd how that just sort of unfolded, and it did become very personal. And, you know, I want to note this: in the 2 years that Anthony and I have been writing about this investigation and going inside of the investigation, no one in the, you know, press corps, those that are following and reporting on the Mueller's investigation, have been able to match us. Okay, they have not been able to do that, largely because, one, we have had, you know, access to certain sources and we've seen certain documents that no one else has.
Right. Well, you have your sources, and they're your sources who obviously you're not going to.
There is a
them.
Belief, though, that you should that other reporters, when they report, when one reports something, that immediately it should be followed up and it should be easy. But as we've seen, right, since the fallout from the publication of our story, and then last week with Michael Cohen's testimony, and even some news this morning, what we have seen is that the essence of our story, the central thesis of it, is absolutely correct.
Yep.
I mean, we can argue and have a debate over whether Michael Cohen was explicitly or implicitly instructed to lie to Congress by President Trump.
Right.
We can have that debate, but let's not lose sight of the fact that that he was in fact directed to lie.
That's
which
right.
is what Anthony and I reported.
And which is what Michael Cohen
has been proven true.
Right. Michael Cohen got on the stand, was at the House Oversight Committee hearing last Wednesday, and he testified explicitly, and I'm using that word on purpose, to the fact that he was directed by the president to do certain things. And so your critics seem now that it's been, you've been vindicated, I believe, by Michael Cohen's testimony and more. In fact, one of the things that you write about in the article was that Trump's lawyers basically edited Cohen's testimony before Congress about the Trump Tower Moscow project. And he said that very clearly on Wednesday. And today, apparently, he produced documents that show the markups to the remarks he was going to make.
Right.
So this is what happened today. So your critics, and there are still some out there, they seem to be hung up
on
the word explicitly. In the story, you write, it is the first known example of Trump explicitly telling a subordinate to lie directly about his own dealings with Russia. And in his own way, the way Michael Cohen described it, the way Donald Trump issues orders, he did explicitly say it.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. And I agree with you. And look, you know, I also want to note that in our story, we revealed that Michael Cohen had at least 10 discussions with Donald Trump about the Trump Tower Moscow project during the course of the campaign.
Mm-hmm.
Michael Cohen testified that there were 10 discussions that took place.
Wow.
He said that in his testimony in response to a question. You know, so with regard to explicitly, look, our, you know, it was in the eighth paragraph of the story. It's still a fair point, right? And you could argue that in his testimony, what Cohen was characterizing, you know, was the directive being more implicit than explicit. But I don't want that to distract from what I think is the more important point, both in Cohen's testimony and in our article, which is that Cohen acknowledged that Trump did, in fact, direct him to lie. We can argue over whether it would be better to characterize that directive as explicit or implicit or somewhere in between, but let's not let that argument distract from what really matters. Cohen testified that Trump directed him to lie, which is what we reported.
Exactly. Exactly. So, I mean, I watched that testimony, and I, as you know, I said all along, I was behind you, but Michael Cohen's testimony vindicated you. And as more and more news breaks throughout the course of this past week, more issues come up that that vindicate you, that show that you and Anthony did good reporting here. And to their credit, BuzzFeed never wavered in their support of your story. They were behind you that day through all the attacks, and sounds like they really have your back, as they should.
They do. And it's been, you know, quite a thing to watch as to how Ben Smith, our editor in chief, has stood behind us. And, you know, at least for the listeners, let me just make it clear that this story, as with all of our stories, and I said this in an interview with The New Yorker, that it goes through the high, underwent the highest level of scrutiny.
Mm-hmm.
You know, multiple editors and lawyers reviewed it. And it was not published until everyone was satisfied that everything was rock solid. This was not something that was just, you know, pushed out there.
Right. So you and Anthony don't just finish a story and click send and it uploads to the BuzzFeed website. It doesn't work that way.
Correct. No. And we spent months on this. You know, as a reminder, Anthony and I wrote what would be, you know, I would consider the definitive story about Trump Tower Moscow last May.
Yes.
And that story revealed all of the communications that Michael Cohen had with another Trump associate, and Felix Sater, about this project. And it was a very lengthy story.
Yes. In fact, I reread it. And I want to ask you about that, because Felix Sater is testifying before Congress a week from tomorrow. And you wrote about him a year ago. It was actually in March. It was March 16th, 2018, because I went back and reread it this morning. And before we had even heard the name Felix Sater, of course, Michael Cohen mentioned him as having occupied his office in Trump Tower, right down the hall from Donald Trump himself. Of course, Donald Trump says he wouldn't know Felix Sater if he was in the room with him, which is bullshit.
Right.
So I
well, not only that, but we released, you know, a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
After the fallout from the story. Well, first, let me just go back to what I was saying.
Okay.
You know, the fact that we published this story last year.
Mm-hmm.
Last May, we published this story. We cited emails, text messages, other documents, and the architectural renderings related to Trump Tower Moscow. 5 months after that story was published, Robert Mueller charged Michael Cohen with lying to Congress. And if you look at that, the criminal information that was submitted to the court in charging Michael Cohen, it lines up with literally everything we reported, right? We also reported in 2017, one day before, you know, Paul Manafort was indicted, that we revealed all the suspicious financial activity and wire transfers that were under scrutiny by Mueller. The next, one day after we published that story, you know, Mueller charged, indicted Manafort, and literally everything we reported was in there. Ivanka Trump, we revealed that she was involved in the Trump Tower Moscow project.
Right.
That was disclosed in a filing by Mueller. My point in saying this is that, you know, we stood behind this story because our sources are solid and our sources have provided us with solid information. And, you know, they informed us to stand our ground, you know, which is why we did not waver, which is why BuzzFeed did not waver.
Wow.
You know, at all on this. I don't know why Robert Mueller's office issued that statement, but I can tell you that they knew the essence of our story was correct. And that, you know, I don't know if things got out of hand in terms of like they were losing control. I mean, you know, there were calls for impeachment. I mean, the story was out. I mean, it really took off in a way that I had not anticipated at all, Nicole.
Right.
You know, perhaps that's a shortcoming, but I did not anticipate that, nor did Anthony. And, you know, because we've been like dug in and, you know, into this. But what I could tell you is that Sunday after we published the story is that Rudy Giuliani went on to CNN and said that, so what if Trump may have spoken to Michael Cohen before his testimony? And that was kind of a big reveal there. That was, that actually kind of helped us, you know, because it opened the door to, you know, kind of what I felt was softening the blow of what would eventually come out, which has come out. Right. And in addition to that, we also learned that weekend that the White House contacted the Department of Justice about our story, that the Department of Justice contacted Mueller's office to find out they were putting out a statement.
Wow.
And last week, Michael Cohen testified. He testified. But yet in the 1 month, no one followed up on any of that to find out what happened. The fact that last week was a big reveal in many ways about, you know, who said what is, you know, what I think that some people in the public who are following this should say is, why am I only hearing about this the first time from Cohen? Why didn't anyone report this?
Right.
So I think that, you know, my feeling is that our critics or colleagues out in the media are being intellectually dishonest and perhaps are invested in us being wrong. And the fact of the matter is that, you know, as I said, we can argue over the use of certain words, but the central thesis of our story was proven true. And honestly, I think there's a lot more to that will be revealed about how the exact words that were perhaps used by Trump to get Cohen to lie. And, you know, as we've seen over the past week, he has allegedly, you know, ordered John Kelly to grant a security clearance to Jared Kushner and Ivanka Trump,
right?
And, you know, ordered Gary Cohn, I believe it was, to, you know, block the AT&T Time Warner merger.
Yep.
I mean, so pressured, directed.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just,
there's a pattern
in ways,
here.
And I am still somewhat stunned by the fact that, you know, what we reported, what appears to me to be that, you know, others out there, and I think the Washington Post and the New York Times are both and examples of this, just didn't bother following up at all and kind of just, you know, let it be.
Right. They were happy to run with the narrative.
Stories about us.
Right. They were happy to run with the narrative that your reporting was flawed rather than try to get to the bottom of it and confirm your findings.
Right. Exactly.
Wow. Jason Leopold is with us again. He's a senior investigative reporter at BuzzFeed News. I'm guessing a day like today, when you know Michael Cohen is there behind closed doors in front of the Intelligence Committee and turning over documents that, again, back up your story, it's got to be hard for you to be sitting here and without knowing what's going on in that room.
It is. And as you can imagine, my colleagues and I are doing as much as we can to find out,
I'm sure,
you know, what we can pry loose. And I believe that, you know, there'll with the House, there'll at least be a transcript that will be released. So,
oh, really? Eventually.
We won't have to wait too long. Yes.
Okay.
I think it's my understanding they will release a transcript of that closed door testimony, obviously redacting, you know, certain elements of it that may pertain to, you know, the ongoing investigation. But yes, we're trying to do that. And, I also want to go back since you mentioned Felix Sater, you know,
yes,
last year in that big profile of Felix Sater, we noted that, yes, he had he had an office three doors down from Trump.
Mm-hmm.
Trump claimed he didn't know him. And a couple of weeks ago, you know, after the fallout from the story, we decided to release all of our documents related to Trump Tower that we obtained. The Trump Tower Moscow project.
Right, right.
The text messages between Felix Sater and Michael Cohen. The emails, the contracts, the letter of intent to break ground on this project, the architectural renderings. We put it all out there along with a timeline of everything Trump was saying about Putin at the same time that Michael Cohen and Felix Sater were discussing this via text message. And the fact that Trump said he did not know Sater came up in their conversation.
Uh-huh.
Right? It came up in the conversation in which Felix is saying to Michael Cohen, I kept my mouth shut like you told me. My kids are crying because they're like, Daddy, do you really not know Donald Trump? You told us that you've known him all these years.
Wow.
You know, and it's not a huge reveal, but what it shows is really what was taking place, you know, behind the scenes, what they were, you know, needing, who needed to keep quiet about all of this. And, you know, I do believe based on, you know, much of the reporting that we did, that the Trump Tower Moscow project is really, really at the center of the investigation. It's quite an important piece.
It is,
you know, to what's being discussed right now that's out there as it relates to, you know, perhaps some sort of collusion. Still don't know what that is or that will ever be proven in a way that the public thinks, right? There have been elements where, you know, some things have been proven, but the way in which, you know, the public is hoping for those that are, you know, that have been following this. But there's still a lot more to this story. And so, you know, it's one of those situations where we got to wait and see what else comes out.
Right.
You know, Michael Cohen obviously is someone who, he pled guilty to lying to Congress. He's a liar. He's lied for Trump, you know, hundreds of times in the past. He admitted.
He threatened for Trump hundreds of times. Right.
So let me
ask you this, Jason. There's if you go to Amazon, they already have it set up where you can pre-order the Mueller report. I saw one. It said introduction by Alan Dershowitz, and they're saying it's going to be released March 26th. Do you know anything about this?
I don't. Oh, you know, I don't know if that's the report.
That's what it says.
I mean, I haven't
heard the Mueller report.
Or if it's just simply a collection of all the court documents that have been released by Mueller thus far. I mean, March 26th.
Yeah,
you know,
it's pretty damn close.
Not that far away.
I know. But then again, there were reports.
I mean, I can tell you I haven't heard anything about a report.
Okay.
Coming out. And it's my expectation that, you know, that nobody should get their hopes up for actually seeing a report. You know, what they'll see, perhaps. I mean, look, the way it's going to likely work is this. Mueller hands off his, you know, findings to the attorney general.
Mm-hmm.
The attorney general reviews it and perhaps sends a summary to Congress, right? Congress then wants the full report. They start haggling over that.
Right.
By the time the public gets to see any sort of big, big report, one, it's likely it could be heavily redacted. And two, there could be a fight. You know, a legal fight, legal battle,
you
know, preventing the, you know,
release
of that. So I just don't think that it's going to be that soon. Perhaps I could be wrong, but knowing the way in which the government works and how much they don't really like transparency, I don't believe that it's, you know, we're going to be so lucky to see it that way.
So do you expect the whole Mueller team releasing that statement was very disconcerting because it led me to believe that they're not as objective as they should be. Although they should be. This is the only time they've ever commented on anything. Have you ever heard from anyone from his office before or after they released that statement?
I did. I only had a heads up from his. From the spokesman of that office, Peter Carr, saying that they were going to release a statement, I should give him a call.
Huh.
And I could tell you, Nicole, I was on the sidewalk in D.C. I believe it was snowing, and I was, you know, my heart dropped.
I'll bet.
Right? Because I knew the magnitude, you know, of what was, you know, I knew how, what the magnitude was of what would, you know, ultimately unfold. I knew mm-hmm. how big that would be. I haven't gotten any other indication as to why, as to what they were, you know, specifically disputing, to what they believe that, you know, we had incorrect or inaccurate. And I can tell you, as I told others, you can be sure I'm going to find out. I mean, I filed a Freedom of Information Act request for every document within DOJ and the special counsel's office to find out what was being discussed about our story in, you know, during the course of those 2 days. I believe that, you know, that I'll eventually find out. But I think the question should be asked is, you know, why did they release that statement? And even, you know, the fact that we know that the like I said, the central thesis was true. I think that what's becoming clear to me is that they wanted to make clear that there were, you know, no leaks perhaps coming from that office. Because if Michael Cohen saying that, look, Trump didn't tell me directly to lie, but he implicitly instructed me to lie because that's the way he is. And I understand his code. He uses code words.
Right.
That's ultimately true to what we reported. I mean, it just is. And the fact that Mueller sort of like his office kind of zeroed in on something within our story, and perhaps it's the fact that we said that, you know, they obtained this information from, you know, in other ways, not simply from Michael Cohen. Perhaps they took issue with that because it sort of characterizes what they have and how else would we have gotten that. So, I mean, I'm very curious about it. It really just appears to, you know, just not be true because they know that what was being, you know, what Michael Cohen said when he was being interviewed.
Right. Now, let me ask you, so when something like this happens, and again, the media piled on and they all started attacking you, does that affect your ability to do your job, to report? I mean, when you call people and reach out to them, have you gotten any sort of rebuffs? Because,
no.
Oh, good. Okay.
Not at all. And, you know, I mean, they're not, you know, responding by like, whoa, Mueller said your story wasn't true. I don't want to
right.
talk to you.
That's, right.
You know, they're not saying that at all. Really what it is that, you know, people have to understand that when you stand behind your sources, you know, the sources and other sources notice that,
mm-hmm.
you know, I mean,
mm-hmm.
we were not caving in any way. And we knew that this was going to be, you know, a pretty ugly month that would lead up to his testimony. And it was, you know, it was a really, really difficult to kind of navigate through all of that. But Anthony and I, you know, we needed to continue to report.
Sure.
And we did. And we have, you know, continued to do so. And no one has said, you know, I'm not going to talk to you guys because you reported this and Mueller released a statement. If anything, you know, I would say that some people are quite interested in speaking to us and like, hey, happened there? What's
right.
going on? You know,
cool.
So, yeah.
So, Jason, what's your next big scoop?
Well, look, we're going to continue following this. Anthony and I are working on a couple of things, which I really can't talk about.
I figured that. I
don't
being
want
facetious.
Mueller to preempt us.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I think there'll be more, more to come in about the next couple of weeks.
Okay. Well, I can't wait. Jason Leopold, obviously, everyone can follow you on Twitter at Jason Leopold. They can find you at BuzzFeed.com. Is it BuzzFeedNews.com, actually?
BuzzFeedNews.com, yes.
BuzzFeedNews.com. Jason Leopold, you are a treasure, and I thank you.
And a number of
listeners in both chat rooms have said to make sure to tell you to thank you for your work. because now more than ever before, it's really important that we value our investigative journalists. There aren't enough of you doing the kind of work that you do, and so we need to be very appreciative that you're there and standing up against this administration who likes to call the press the enemy of the people.
Yeah, it's true. Thank you, Nicole.
Thank you, Jason Leopold. It's great to talk with you, and I'm so glad things worked out this way, as I knew they would, but vindication is a wonderful thing. Thank you so much, Jason.
Yeah.
Take care. Bye-bye. All right, and that does it for us for today. We'll be back tomorrow. It's Thursday with Howie Klein. Bye, everyone.